Well, good morning. It's great for me to be here. It's a wonderful opportunity because doing basic research in a basic science hospital, normally I don't see patients. So for me, this is a particular day because you make me aware of the things we have to address as well. So I'm based at the University of Leipzig, and Leipzig is a city not only famous for its university, but also famous for its music, especially Johann Sebastian Bach and Mendelssohn Bartholdy. They basically spent most of their life and their career in Leipzig. So it's really a wonderful place to be there, and it's quite gifted. So what my lab is interested in is basically what keeps our skin firmly together. And this is a story of fibers and buttons. As you know, the skin is composed of keratinocytes mostly, and they need to maintain the physical resilience of this organ. And this resilience against stress, shear stress, torsional stress, is based on this network of fibers and filaments. Here you can see the filaments by electron microscopy, and here you see that those filaments are anchored to those knobs, and this together sticks the cells together. And how did I come to work on those questions? I was trained at the German Cancer Center in Heidelberg many years ago. My supervisor at that time was Werner Franke, and he was one of the discoverers of those cytoskeletal fibers. And here we can see cells in which keratin fibers that make up those fibers are stained by an antibody in individual skin cells. So that's how this structure looks if it's normal, intact, and functioning. Now, there's a lot of secrets of those fibers, and I would like you to understand some of the basics. So keratin fibers basically come in two flavors, in two types of subunits, the red one and the blue one, and they're essential to stick together to make those filaments. And I brought a little tubing from the lab in order to make you understand how it's working. So it's those two fibers, very elastic. So as you can see, they contact each other, and what I do with my hands now, this is done by the properties of the building blocks of those fibers, amino acids. And they have different properties. They are charged, they attract each other, they're hydrophobic, like oil and water. So in this combination of building blocks here makes those subunits stick together very, very tightly. And this is important for what I tell you in a minute. And all those interactions between those subunits make those long fibers that you can see in the microscope that travel the cell. In order to study those fibers, of course, it's understood you can't do it in patients. So my lab has two model systems to study the biological properties of those fibers and try to understand how mutations that disrupt them really cause the disease that many of you are suffering from. So the first model system we have is the mouse, and we can use the mouse because the genes in the mouse are highly conserved compared to the humans. And I learned how to make mouse models of disease actually in this country, further north in Scotland, in the lab of David Melton, where I spent postdoctoral time in the early 90s. The second model system is more close, and this is basically skin cells that we can either grow from genetically modified mice or from human patients that we have in collaboration with the German Reference Center for EB in Freiburg. So this is basically our working horses in order to understand disease mechanisms. And the third inspiration I got in the lab in order to work in EB was when I was in the UK as a postdoc, I met Robin Eady in the mid-90s in London, and he basically brought me in contact with the disease. And as you now know, EB simplex is caused by many, many different mutations in those keratin genes. And this is worked by many, many people. And what you can see here is that those building blocks of keratins have a wide range of mutations. And what one would like to know is how those mutations change the stickiness among the molecules and at the end of the day cause those fibers no longer to be fibers, but to be aggregates in the cytoplasm that are no longer able to withstand torsional pressure, shear stress, and whatever is essential for the skin to work. And as you probably know, if there is mutations, the skin no longer is intact, but if you look by the microscope, you see that physical stress basically causes those fibers to rupture, and macroscopically this means that the skin blisters. Now at the level of the single skin cells, those wonderful fibers no longer are fibers, but they form protein aggregates in the cytoplasm of the cell. And by electron microscopy, you can see further details, and it's very obvious from the image I showed you a minute before that this is no longer fibers, but this is basically useless structures. So the challenge is, what can you do in order to prevent this, or what can you do in order to revert this, possibly? Now, in order to understand that, and this is the type of message I'd like to convey, is you need to understand nitty-gritty details of how those fibers are built up. And you can understand that, and you need to understand that at several levels. You need to understand it at the molecular level. So those mutations change locally the glue between the subunits, that they no longer stick properly. And they change the charge between the fibers, that they no longer stick properly, but they are disoriented. And this leads to altered interactions of those keratin proteins. And at the cellular level, you realize when you look in the microscope, as I've shown you, the cytoskeleton aggregates in those protein aggregates. Cell components that are important for other functions of the cell are trapped in those aggregates, so the cell no longer can properly use glucose, it starts to get infections, and so on. So also metabolism of the cell is altered, and therefore wound healing is affected. And at the tissue level, at the level of skin, as you are very aware, the skin becomes very fragile. Often it develops inflammation, it develops itch, and now we're getting the first insights how itch is developing, what this has to do with keratin fibers. And in addition, some of you may suffer seasonal variation. So from what I've learned from the literature and from talking to a few patients is that some people do better in winter than in summer. This is an interesting question. Why is this? Why is ambient temperature affecting the skin condition? So before I come to that, what are the treatment options? Ben already has shown you some of what becomes reality at the moment and some of the strategies, and I've summed this up very simply. So in a normal skin, you have those cytoskeletal fibers and the knobs that stick the cells together. In EB simplex skin, we have aggregates. Those aggregates also weaken the knobs, so the cells no longer stick together, they fall apart. And this is what you would like to revert or to prevent in the first place. There's basically two strategies that you can think of. The first one is you can alleviate the condition by treating inflammation and itch, or you can use compounds to prevent or to revert aggregation of keratin filaments. And much more complicated, but you have heard that this is now beginning to work, you can use gene therapy to correct the genetic defect. This is definitely a long way to go, but it may work, it will work at the end, I'm optimistic. So in my lab, 2 years ago, in a PhD thesis of a young student, we took on this question, what is the reason for the seasonal variability? Why do some mutations cause EB simplex in summer, but less so in winter? And what we realized when we modeled this in our workhorse in skin cells was that when we culture the cells at normal temperature, they would make normal keratin fibers. However, when we would expose the cells to slightly elevated temperature, suddenly this transforms into aggregates. So somehow the temperature changes this mutation, the cytoskeleton with mutations into those aggregates. So the question is, can we exploit that? What does it mean? And the surprising observation Melanie made is, when she reverted the temperature and put the cells back to lower temperature, the aggregates would reappear, they would dissolve, and form normal filaments again. So this means certain mutations do something to keratin fibers that make them temperature sensitive. What is this? And at this point, I got a phone call from a colleague in Ann Arbor, in the United States, who said, Thomas, we have made a compound screen in order to look at so-called post-translational modifications in keratins in order to see whether this has any effect on keratin structure. Now, what are those post-translational modifications? They are changes in single amino acids. Like the mutations change single amino acids, the cell also has ways to modify keratin interactions. And what we realized at that point is that the season variability is caused by a mutation that in the second place also changes keratin charges. So then we thought, well, if this special mutations cause secondary changes, maybe we can use drugs to prevent this. And one of those drugs came up in this screen. And now the observation, the key observation is, this is the cells I've shown you before that at elevated temperature shows those aggregates. Now, if we pre-treat the cells before we expose them to elevated temperature with a drug, for 24 hours, you prevent formation of aggregates in the first place. The mutation is still there, but the secondary post-translational modification, so to speak, is prevented by the drug. So what is this drug? Before I show you that, the drug not only prevents formation of aggregates, but it also helps to make keratinocytes stick together with those knobs that are stained in green here. So this also means that the skin as itself is more stable against torsional stress. Oops, I think I'm missing one slide. Basically, you have deleted one. So I briefly tell you without a slide what the drug probably does. It's known that the drug changes a certain charge that occurs on keratins by interfering with the enzyme that introduces the drug. So, and based on the basic knowledge we are beginning to have on this, we've applied to DEBRA in order to study basically the working mechanism of the drug and to see whether this drug can be used as a therapeutic compound. So basically, what we will do in this three-year project that starts off June 1st, so in 10 days, a postdoc, Katrin Reacher, will join the lab in order to do the work. So first, we will use simplex keratinocytes to see how the compound is actually working, whether it's specific for keratins, whether it does something else. And this is very vital in order to know what is the right concentration, how frequently has it to be applied, and so on. The second thing is to move one step further from cultured cells in a plastic dish to a more relevant model. And the relevant model between cultured cells and you as a patient is still an animal model. And the way we will do this is to transplant EBS keratinocytes that have been treated with a drug onto the skin of a special strain of mice that tolerate this. And then we will see whether, following the transplantation, those keratinocytes form a proper piece of skin on the back of those mice. And if that works, one can move on, but then I think there's another challenge. From the data that are available at the moment, it's clear the drug may be a good start, but we would like to have a drug that is even more specific with less side effects. And this will be the third step. The vision is if this drug or its follow-up drug works, it will be used as a cream or as a solvent that is locally put on the skin in order to prevent or alleviate blistering. And this, of course, is a way to go, but it's a very promising route because it's a non-invasive treatment we're envisaging there. Well, I'm nearly at the end, and I would like, as you have seen, to thank the team, because everything, as Ben has pointed out, this is the same for us. Research like the one we are doing and like most other people are doing is teamwork. You never can stand alone because things become so complex that you need support, knowledge, technology from many other people around the world. And this is basically my group, current members of the group, past members who have now started their own labs or went to industry, and there is a long list of supporters who bring in certain technologies and other types of knowledge that are vital. And I would like to end with a motto that I've taken from Henry James, and still true despite all the knowledge, we still work in the dark. But we do what we can and we give what we have. And without passion, nothing will work. Thank you.
Thank you. That was a super presentation, and if you go back to, come that way a bit, if we go back to what Ben said at the beginning about repurposing drugs, this is a very good example of taking drugs and finding that they have a secondary action. I don't know whether anybody's got a question, perhaps you do, we've also got some question cards, but I've got one for Thomas, which is how long do you think it will take before we could perhaps try one of these drugs in some patients rather than in the laboratory?
I'm always very cautious making such statements because one of the things that I have learned and I think many people alike have learned is you have understood one aspect and suddenly something is happening that is unexpected on your way. But I would say in the 3 years we will be able to develop a better drug that works in a cell culture model. And then maybe it's in the range of, if you push me, another 5 to 8 years before that can move on.
It's yeah?
The thing is that we most likely screen for drugs, this will be done in Dundee and in Ann Arbor, that are already clinically available. So one can be optimistic, but there is still steps to manage.
Yeah, again, super presentation. Thank you very much. Does anybody have another question? Oh, my goodness. I'll give you my microphone then.
Amazing insight. Thank you very much. You're looking at EB simplex, but you're getting the same problem, and I know it's at a different level, in recessive and dystrophic EB. Do you think this insight will translate during the course of your research over the next few years?
Well, I think the basic principles are highly conserved in evolution. So those interactions that make keratin stick together are also true for collagens, for laminin, for any other diseased gene as well. So I think the nice thing about cell biology, biochemistry, is that you begin to see from all this in-depth work, you begin to see parallels. And you can translate the understanding of mechanisms in one disease to another disease. So it will not be the identical route, but the principles will be similar. And I'm convinced that in addition to a causal therapy, gene therapy, that those other routes where one uses repurposed drugs with local applications will be very promising.
Thank you very much for coming from Germany. It's really good to understand a bit more about your research. I was really interested to understand how there was recovery when the temperature was dropped. So just in the treatment of EB simplex now, so if patients were to, obviously hypothesis, it's not your research, but anecdotally, if patients were to cool their hands and feet immediately, there would be some cell recovery. Do you want to tell me about the technique?
Yeah. I know what... Well, I just go here. So, I think there's maybe two different things I should point out. The recovery, this is something natural, whereas what the drug is doing, it has prevented the formation of aggregates in the first place. So the recovery in cultured cells is much faster than it is in a tissue. So what the timeline in cultured cells is very rapid, 15 minutes. In mouse tissue, we know the recovery takes several days. And this is because those fibers are connected to many more knobs, so to speak, in real skin than it is in cultured cells. So what you're describing actually may help, but it will be much better to prevent aggregation in the first place. Now, the good thing is that the cell continuously synthesizes keratins and degrades it. So if the mechanism kicks in by a cream or by a solvent that you can use drugs like this, you may be able to minimize the aggregation in the first place on a continuous basis.
Thank you very much.
Any further questions? I think we might have time for one, otherwise we'll move on to our next presentation. No, we'll take one more question.
It was just really on potential clinical trials. What's the restraint, if we say 5 to 8 years? Would more funding help to shorten that time?
I mean, it's always good to have more money, which is very true, yeah? I mean, for example, if one does a compound screen, this costs an enormous amount of money, as Ben has said. Now, the amount of money we have available at the moment is limited, so we can only screen a small library of compounds. But it's not always the money. It's when you go along and you have more insight, you suddenly realize things are more complicated than you knew before, so then there's a roadblock. And then it rather takes your intellect than money, which slows it down. So you need to solve the problem and then you move on. It's money plus dedication, I would say.
Thank you again, Thomas. That was fantastic.